what was it, Solo with the space kraken?
Oh, the Star Wars movie?
Yeah.
No, I did not. I have yet to see that. I have yet to see. Actually, I haven't seen any new movies this year.
Well, that's all I have to...
This year? Yeah.
My review of Solo so far is, hey, it has a space kraken in it.
Well, that's worth watching, because space krakens rule.
Yeah.
There it is.
And Lando has a cape room.
There we go.
Which I also approve of.
See, that's that thing I was telling you about. There we go. Right there. We're going to put it right there. Block all my crap that I've got piled up back there.
I see a GameCube, and that's about it. That's the only thing I can really tell in some
books. Oh, the GameCube is over there somewhere.
Yeah.
I'm not even watching my thing. Anyway, okay. GameCube is GameCube. Lots of Magic cards. That right there, I believe, is a Wii. And then I've got PsyQuest drives and some other old video games. And then back here is just it's just a bunch of books. But no, down here on the ground, I had a bunch of construction crap. I was like, I'm just getting the wheels of this out of the way.
Did you hack the shit out of your Wii?
My Wii? No, but I'm doing, I've got the cool little thing for the Switch, actually.
Oh, is that like the
now jump, that we can? Yeah, that's the jumper. So the way the whole thing works is you've got a jumper pins 1 and 10 down in this thing that's where the Joy-Con connects to. Okay. And when you do that, you can boot it in... basically, you boot it in like boot ROM mode.
Well, all you have to do on the classics to do that is just hold down reset and hit power.
Well, yeah. That's actually really funny.
Yeah, they made it simple.
Yeah, no, so this one here, they made it so they didn't want you to do this, but because it's a Tegra, things that are like that. So I just, you basically take a paper clip, you fold it all up, and you bend it in place so when you can literally drop this down into the Joy-Con rail, and it jumpers those two pins, which is like holding down your reset button.
Gotcha.
In your classic. So it's,
thanks for
it's
the follow, whoever. I didn't see what it was, but I'm just going to tell you. That shouldn't exist because I annihilated all the stream stuff from here, but for some reason we still got the follow alert sound.
Oh, cool. Well, yeah, now we can jump up and down and join. Woo!
Yeah.
Either that or you're getting it and I'm not, because I don't know. Are they getting it there?
Oh, it's going through Discord, I'm sure.
Oh, well, I can't hear it here and I'm not I'm watching the stream here, so I
don't know. Okay, cool. Yay. So, anyways, this is episode 21 of Trial Run, or Trail Run, depending on how it's spelled.
You got it's trial right now. You got a trial.
Okay. Yeah. It's funny that we just accept that this is something that I do now.
It's typo stuff?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So anyways, we were talking about switches and hacking. What are you going to do with yours? Are you going to like...
I just want to put the homebrew stuff on there because now I've got... You know, I've got the Wii and the GameCube, as we pointed out. But the problem with them is they were not designed for digital connections, right? Like the Super NES. The old Super NES has got an old RF modulator where you can get the RCA plugs, but it's all analog signals. There's no HDMI for a Super NES, right?
Does your GameCube have the second digital port on the back?
I believe it does. So I can likely hook that kind of stuff up to that. I know the Wii does have an HDMI port for it, but the Switch connects directly up to whatever, you know, it's just you plug it into the dock, connect the HDMI to whatever, you got audio, and from there you put the homebrew stuff on there and you can dump a bunch of old NES classic stuff and SNES stuff on there and just kind of go crazy with it, in which case now I've got a device that is designed to connect to a very large screen in digital format, and then I can play all the old stuff. That's really the whole the idea that I had on it.
Is it RetroArch at that point running on it?
They've got some kind of homebrew stuff. I haven't really dug too far into it yet because I wasn't able to get this thing working, and I realized that I don't have a USB Type A to Type C connector that's not for my OnePlus, and I was like, I don't really feel comfortable. Did some wiring weirdness with the OnePlus phones, and I don't want to find out that it's gonna, you know, cause an electrical fire on my Switch. Mm. They did something for the fast charging for the OnePlus 3T and the 5 and all those ones, is that if you the cable that they use moved some wires around, I think. Yeah, that, or like it's those, just,
I know there's like extra dock hookups for the Switch, like the little mini ones.
Yeah.
Some of those stopped working after an update because I guess Nintendo went over the USB spec for power. So you might be fine.
Maybe. I don't know. I just don't want to find out that the cable that's used for this thing is wired funny and it causes some kind of like pin misalignment and causes a voltage to go on a line that's not supposed to be there.
Yeah.
Anyway, so yeah, I'm gonna plug it in and get kind of goofy with it, but yeah. I talked to a friend of mine and I got him printing me up you can get them on eBay, but I had access to someone, so I said, hey, can you do this for me? It's a jig. It's just a little piece of 3D printed thing that the paper clip actually goes into, and then it just slides down the rail on the Switch, so it jumpers those, so you can put it in the ROM mod node, and then boot it up, and then do your firmware loading and a few other things. You got to connect it to the computer, USB, and dump a payload onto the system so that it you change the firmware. And the cool part about this hack that they figured out is that because it's one of those things, it's not a flaw. It's not like the modification here is a vulnerability. It's a feature of the chipset that is being exploited to do something that the device was not intended for. That's a lot of big words, but basically when you, as a hardware developer, you would want this feature available so you can, you know, load and reload and mess with the CPU. It's just like your phone booting up into like a boot ROM mode is a feature of the device. So you can manipulate the device, but more from a manufacturer's standpoint, it's not really intended for all us crazy hardware hackers to use it, or, you know, an end user. But that's basically what's going on with the Switch, is that you jumper this thing, you boot it up into boot mode, and then you can modify it. It's pretty nifty. But the cool part is that it's so far it is firmware independent. Mm-hmm. And up until yesterday, I didn't update my Switch. So I was running version like 3.02, and this modification can work all the way up to 5.1 as of right now. So now I'm on 5.1, which was nice. I made the fatal mistake when I had a PlayStation Portable, a PSP, that I updated it. I dropped in one of those UMD discs and updated it to something, and then I was unable to put homebrew stuff on there. So this has kind of been a 10-year sob story for me. I finally get to do it.
I messed up a battery pretty bad on PSP. I bought an extra battery, and then I did the trick where you take the battery apart and you jump the two pins on there to install the firmware. And for whatever reason, when I stuck my regular battery in it, was like the really nice like white Darth Vader silk screen PSP, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it screwed that sucker up really bad.
I do not know what you're talking about. I did not do something very similar.
Oh, my favorite one was the Wii. The Wii was the best one because you stuck like some weird like INI file or something like that, from what I remember, on an SD card. You went into Twilight Princess into a certain spot, like this magical spot, and then walked towards the screen, and then all of a sudden the hack worked. I was like...
That's awesome. See, that right there is a full-on exploit of it has something to do with the way you're setting up the system code in RAM, basically. Yeah. And that once it's aligned in a certain way with this exploit kind of shoved in the side, that when you make those changes to the code, it executes that. That's ridiculous.
Yeah, that was funny because it was just like you're in Zelda and all of a sudden it's just like, and then you see like all this code showing up on your screen and it's like, would you like to press A to install firmware or something? I'm like, okay, sure, yeah.
Computers, man. There's some cool high-tech stuff.
The Wii was probably one of my favorite in a long time because they had the homebrew channel. They had all that crazy stuff where you could literally, and I don't condone this, but I kind of do, where you could put, like, say you rented a game. You could put the disc in and have the Wii itself natively burn the disc onto an external hard drive and just run the games off of an external hard drive.
Oh, that's crazy.
Yeah. I love that thing. That thing was awesome to hack. And then, like, I ended up taking it back to GameStop, and I just tried wiping it as best as I can. It's like, don't notice that the screw holes are missing. Don't notice.
No, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Speaking of crazy hacks and other miscellaneous cool things, mm-hmm. you can kind of see it sitting right there.
Oh, that original PlayStation?
A PlayStation 3.
Mm-hmm.
It is the 60 gig version, the very first generation. I found it at a Goodwill store for $4.
Wow.
And the, like, I think the credit card or the, you know, the card minimum when you run your debit card minimum was like $5. Like, would you like to donate $1 to bring yourself? So I spent $5 on this thing. The only problem with it right now is the Blu-ray drive is borked. So I got to get a new drive and do the, you have to match the controller board to the system. So you have to remove the Blu-ray drive, remove the control board from the bottom, put it onto the new drive, and put it back into the system. It has to be all paired up and kind of a
weird if you need any parts or power supply for it, I got tons for that particular model.
Nice.
I also have a 60 gig that's not working, so if you just want to use it for spare parts.
Okay. Yes, parts are cool.
Okay.
But yeah, so far this one, I plugged it in, I got it all turned on, and I ran through a series of discs. I had this issue with the PlayStation 2, is that the DVD laser and the CD laser they're two different mechanisms. In the, this is the module with the laser, at least this is with the PlayStation 2 anyway. It's got a laser for the DVD, and it had a laser for the CD-ROM. And at one point, the DVD laser got all out of alignment and got all messed up, and it stopped reading discs. And it was actually a fault with the manufacturing fault with those first-generation PlayStation 2s. But the CD kept working, so I dropped in a disc, and it would, like, mess up with the DVD, and it would read a CD just fine, which I thought was kind of nifty. So with this one, I went through Blu-ray, DVD, and CD, and what I found was this crappy game that I somehow acquired. I actually have no idea really when or how I ended up with this disc. I have a copy of Transformers, the game, for PlayStation 2. this one is a DVD. So the PlayStation 2 DVD, it worked just fine. But the PlayStation 3 Blu-rays and PlayStation 1 CDs and PlayStation 2 CDs, none of those worked. So the CD and the Blu-ray part of the mechanism is all effed up. So
I'm sure the disc drive in this one still works. You just gotta put it in there, basically.
Cool.
Yeah. But it sounds to me like the Blu-ray part of the diodes burn out or something like that.
Probably. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it happens. And then I got another buddy of mine who used to mod the crap out of these. Sure, you swap out all of your heatsink grease and your thermal pads, get better thermal pads, get this. I'm like, wow. Because these things were notoriously hot.
Yeah. There's also the issue, and they suffered from the same problem with the Xbox, I remember. There's like right around that time when they were coming out, so they were designed with lead solder in mind.
Mm.
And I think it was not the FCC, but the EPA basically said you can't have lead and solder anymore. And they were just kind of like, well, fuck. So they put them on there, you know, ball grid array, but then obviously it was designed for a much higher temperature. And then what happened is as the boards would warp, the solder would crack, right? So it's like, honestly, like all that stuff with like the red ring and stuff was really, honestly, it was just the EPA kind of screwed them over at the last minute, because like that came out like right before they started manufacturing on both of those. And meanwhile, Nintendo's like, "Huh, we're just a GameCube, so whatever."
GameCube is still awesome, which is why I have. Actually, it's funny. I have one right there, and I have another one in a cabinet down beneath it. I've got to this point where I walk into these thrift stores, and I just stumble across old consoles, and I'm like, "I'll take it, $5." Yeah. I bought a PlayStation, PlayStation 1. I want to say it was like 2 months ago, 3 months ago. I was up in Nashville. No, I was mid last year. I was up in Nashville on a cabling job, and I walked into this thrift store, and they had a PlayStation. There was no cables, no controllers. It was just the PlayStation, but it did have a memory card, a PlayStation 1 memory card. I'm like, "How much for just the memory card?" And they're like, $2.99. I'm like, "Well, that's how much the whole thing is for. I just want the memory card." We're like, "Well, it's all one unit." Like, "Okay, $3. I have a memory card."
Yeah.
And another PlayStation.
I mean, I still love playing on those old consoles. The games are not, they hold up.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. No, I've got part of the reason why when I found this, I was like, "This is fantastic," is because my goal is to get this thing fixed and working. And I have this stack of old PlayStation 1, PlayStation 2, and some PlayStation 3 games. And I'm just going to play through all of them, and I'm going to stream the crap out of it. So.
Hell yeah. Symphony of the Night, damn it.
I don't have that one. I do have Xenogears. So that's that one, and Vagrant Story are both ones that I really want to go through. Legend of Mana is one that I really want to kick into. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, I've got Final Fantasy 1, 2, 4, 5, 6, Chrono Trigger, Chrono Cross. Do I have Chrono Cross still? Yeah, I should. Suikoden. You remember Suikoden?
Yeah.
That was a great game. I have 1 and 2 because they're both fantastic. Then I got a couple of the really terrible ones. I have Lunar 1 and 2, which is pretty awesome. And then my PlayStation 2 stuff.
I have some PS1 games sitting over here. I don't know. What you looking for?
I don't know. I'm just reading off literally my list of my collection of PS1 games that I still have.
I know like Wing Commander's over there. I know there's like there's that one Street Fighter 2 that apparently is going for a lot of money for whatever reason.
Oh, wow.
It's like Street Fighter Collection 2. It's just basically the original three arcade games, and it goes for like $60-$70. Metal That's Gear's crazy. Over there.
Ooh, speaking of Metal Gear, that is actually something I picked up recently. Is this it? No, that's my Linux PlayStation 2. Ooh, yeah.
Ooh.
Where did it go?
I wonder if that works on the PlayStation 3 if the Linux thing was still going.
I don't know. I did pick this up the other day. I picked up it's the God of War collection.
Mm-hmm.
So it's all five games. And then I've got the Metal Gear Solid Saga that's got all of the Metal Gear games, minus Snake's Revenge, which this is one of those things where I played that game when I was younger because it was one of the first Metal Gear games that I actually got a hold of, was Metal Gear Snake's Revenge.
Well, and, you know what you can play Snake's Revenge on.
Well, but the thing is that Snake's Revenge turns out wasn't the actual sequel to Metal Gear.
No.
And I didn't realize, I think we had a conversation about this before. Mm-hmm. So I went ahead and picked that up. So I have the Metal Gear 2 Solid Snake, which I did not know even existed because I haven't looked at Metal Gear Solid in such a long time.
Yeah. It's not a bad game either.
But I have it now.
Yeah.
Of course, I have to find out where I put it.
So speaking of playing and hacking things.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What is this? And then I've got... Oh, yeah. This is my latest and greatest Octopath Traveler is
I wanna
play
that
Switch game. It is... it's an interesting game, to say the least. I keep having to remind myself that it's on a Switch because the Switch is like meant to be taken and portable.
Mm-hmm.
Even though it's got there's a lot of elements to the game that make me think that it's meant for a much, much younger audience, which is your general Nintendo game. But otherwise it's dark. Like, holy crap, out of the eight characters, the one I chose is a dancer. And by dancer, I mean, like, we're talking, like, burlesque type dancer.
Okay.
But her intro is she's interacting with the guy who owns effectively the brothel that she works in, and by works in, I mean he owns her and the rest of the dancers, and it very roughly touches on the fact that, oh yeah, he's the owner of all of these women, and I'm just like, holy crap, this is dark. Except she's there as she's actually like the daughter of a noble, and she put herself there on a mission to find the men who killed her dad. And like this is just the opening introduction to her story, is that she sees the guy, one of the three guys that killed her dad, in the brothel and is ready to pretty much just jump ship. He's like, oh yeah, that's it, I found this mother, I'm gonna go kick his ass. And the owner of the brothel like stops her, and she beats the ever living tar out of him. I mean, like, we're talking full on.
Nice.
It was like, damn. But it's that whole section is so dark. I'm like, I can't believe they put this in a game. So dark.
What I've seen of that game so far, like, that game is like one of the sellers. I want to get the Switch. You know.
Yeah.
Like, I really want to play it really badly.
There's your two games that you want so you can get a Switch. That's it. There you go. Which two do you think I have?
Oh, I got more on my list than that. Like,
oh yeah, no,
I want to play Rabbids because it's an RTS that is looks like it's balls crazy.
RTS on a Rabbids? What is it?
Well, not RTS. What do you call it? Strategy game. So sort of like XCOM. Yeah. Yeah, I misspoke there. But yeah, it's, I don't know. It just appeals to me. I like it. I think it looks fun. Obviously, I want to play Mario.
Mario plus Rabbids Kingdom Battle. Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah, Mario Kart. Like, I'm insanely good at Mario Kart games. I will absolutely destroy anybody at Mario Kart. I will destroy you so bad that it'll screw up your next generations.
See, I haven't played Mario Kart in so long. I have some buddies of mine who want to, next time I'm in Arizona, they want to have a don't drink and drive Mario Kart party.
Yeah. Did you see that they did a mod now where you can actually play Duck Hunt on a LCD?
No.
There's a Kickstarter where basically it's a patched version of Duck Hunt. It's insanely expensive. It's like $120. But they give you a board just to basically stick in them in the Duck Hunt cartridge. It's like patch code. And then they give you another board that clips onto the wiring inside the light gun, and then it makes it work on LCDs.
I mean, I've seen some mods for the zapper to where it does, but wow.
Yeah.
Wow, that's awesome.
I mean, I'm thinking drunk Mario or drunk duck hunt again. A duck hunt again. Like, you miss a duck, you have to drink. There's no proof that I'm not drinking now, so
I'm just
Yeah. Chris says, I actually have a first gen PS1 with a Game Shark port and is fully modded on both ripped and port games. So the Game Shark port was a parallel port that was originally designed. That's what the Super Nintendo was supposed to hook up to.
I should pull out my PlayStation 1.
The add-on. Just like pulled out of your pants. Here's my PlayStation 1.
It's actually in a box on the other side over there. Yeah. One of four. I either have four or I have five PlayStation 1s, like original generation PlayStation 1s. One of them is the Audiophile's wet dream PlayStation with the direct line audio output. And then the other three or four are just various generations of PlayStation 1.
Yeah. Yeah, I had the first one, but the disc drive always keeps it screwing up on those. So.
It's like, yeah. That's why I have so many of them.
Yeah.
But again, back to the issues. Right now, the biggest problem I have is that I have no way of playing any of these old consoles. There is a There is a video capture device that I have to get my hands on again that is got analog inputs. And once I get that, I can plug in all these old systems.
You got one of these?
What is that?
It's an Elgato HD.
No, I have one of these. It's a Magewell.
Well, my cable's around here somewhere. Anyways, there's cables for this.
Anyway, this one is USB 3 and it's HDMI.
That's a good question, where my cables go.
No, anyway, there's one that I used to have that I want to get a hold of again. That is really awesome. Otherwise, I've got this machine's got an all-in-wonder. I just don't know if it will work.
Yeah,
it's older than the PlayStation. So
if all else fails, what you can do is you can get like a cheap Elgato HD 60 or not 60, just regular HD. As long as it's got the cables that comes with it, it's like it's component hookups, but you can actually like hook it up so composite will work on it too. And then just the computer upscales the image from that point. So that's another, you know, route. You have a CRT there?
No.
That's
one thing I no longer have. I got rid of all my CRT monitors. I don't have any more CRT TVs. I do, however, have some old Dell flats panels that have analog inputs. So I can play these games. I just can't do anything like stream them, which is one of the reasons why I'm like, I mean, I can play all these things any day of the week. You know, I've got PlayStation and whatnot, and you can, you know, whatever. I just don't want to stream it without having I have the actual console, I have this, and I have it.
What about,
that's why this thing is a real.
What about OSSC?
Is that the emulator?
No, OSSC's a line doubler.
Oh.
It's open source. Open source scan converter.
Oh, gotcha. Yeah, no, I don't have one of those. That would be nifty. I'll have to look into that a more.
We'll talk about it later. Yeah. Anyways, as far as what I've been playing a lot of, I guess we're in the what we've been playing section. I've been playing a lot of Nintendo, obviously, since I got this thing the other day, and found out that Nintendo still has the ROM bootloader on there for the Famicom Disk System. So I've been playing a lot of Famicom Disk System games on the NES Classic.
Nice.
It's funny, because it still has the load times and everything.
That's awesome. Some kind of weird way.
So I've been playing a game called, we'll play it on stream later today, called something like Kick Challenger or something like that. It's, you're basically a tomato with feet. And bear with me. You hold A and you move the D-pad in any direction to walk. And you can see your feet going like this. You know, like you can tell which one's in the air, which one's not. And at any point you see an enemy, you need to stop and you can press B to fire your foot in one direction or the other, depending on where you're pressing the D-pad. It sounds dumb, but it's interesting. I mean, you're playing a tomato with feet.
That blew a fuse in my brain thinking about that, and then my phone buzzed at me with all these people clicking on my Twitter link that I posted for this thing. So hopefully we'll get some more people in here.
Yeah.
Not that I'm looking or caring or watching.
It's been a while.
It's been a while since I've been online somewhere.
Yeah. But yeah.
But yeah, Chris, you're right. That thing was not cheap.
Let's see. And then other than that, I played some new games. I played like Westerado, which kind of reminded me like an old, like really old PC game in the way that it like hit, like most of the controls are on the keyboard. Like it's a Western where you're like obviously like shooting stuff and all that, but it's like press J or something like that to unholster your weapon, press K to cock your weapon, press K to fire your weapon. It's like, but I don't know, seems cool so far. keep playing.
I know. I thoroughly enjoyed watching you get your ass kicked on Kung Fu.
Kung Fu's fun. My main thing is I just like punching shit in the nuts in Kung Fu.
That game is hilarious. No, that is. That is. It's the nut punch game.
Yeah. And it's like, I don't.
But you gotta be careful because when the midgets, and I mean that, they're like these tiny little dudes. Mm-hmm. When they come running up at you, if you're ducked down, they will jump over and land on your head, and you have to jump at the same time. And then you jump, your knee comes up, so you still end up nut crunching them, but you're doing it with a jump knee to the groin. And then they die.
My favorite thing is that the sound effect when you die, it sounds like you're getting a boner as you die. It's like, it's like, I don't know why to decide that particular sound effect for when you die, but sure, why not?
The game is great. Yeah. It is. It's a great game. I might still have my original cartridge. That was one of the first NES games that I ever owned.
I'm slowly getting some stuff back. I sold a lot when my wife got sick. And totally. So I had a whole NES collection, and I had to sell it all. So, anyways, let's see. And he says he's been playing Duke Nukem Fun with Duke Nukem Campaign on Bulletstorm Full Clip Edition. Bulletstorm was a good game. I played a lot of it on PS3.
I just liked the interactive commercial for that game.
Yeah.
Duty Calls. Is the best advertisement campaign I have ever seen. Next to Hawaii 5-0, by the way. Hawaii 5-0 is the best. That is the best advertising campaign I've ever seen. This Hawaii 5-0.
I think my favorite thing in that whole entire game, though, is there's a pistol that I remember. It's like the special fire. If you happen to shoot somebody in the ass, they go up in the air like a firework and blow up in the same way. It's pretty great.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So, anyways, we got a couple of news things here. Not really news, just interesting stuff. I thought it'd be more interesting if we just kind of went on a tangent.
I agree, but I do actually want to talk about this one. I didn't actually click on this link, just the fact that this is the title of this is that the Colonial Marines game may very well have had the dumb AI because of a single typo.
Yeah.
That is QA. That is bad, bad QA.
Yeah.
So bad QA.
So they actually went through and they played the game before they fixed the typo in the INI. And the aliens are doing the same stupid kind of running all over the place, nonsensical, not like really paying attention to the player in the game.
Mm-hmm.
Then they go and add it, and then all of a sudden the aliens are like actively going after everybody, tracking the player, all that stuff.
So it's either a typo or it's we made this thing so great that they're this game is damn near impossible, kind of like actually being in a movie.
So yeah, you can see like they're just going straight after him here. It's not even. Okay. Oh, that one's not working. Anyways. Yeah, that blew my mind. I'm like, I don't know how you just not catch that. Like, it was under enough hot water when it didn't look the way that they originally presented it, right? I don't remember if there's any particular reason for that. It just came out looking worse, I think. But...
Okay, hold on. I actually were looking at this about a TV user. Da, 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 da. Wow. The typo could correct the erratic behavior of the xenomorphs to a degree. Wow.
Oh, yeah. Have you ever played this?
No, it was one of those games that it was so bad, and it had such a negative, not even the reviews, it was just like the general populace of this game was so terrible, don't bother touching it. I don't even remember if I ended up with it or not, and now that I've said that, I'm gonna go and find out, because so, if I have this game, I'm gonna do a test of this myself.
Yeah,
I like verifying whether or not things are stupid or not.
Yeah, so the AI would literally run around the map, going in no particular direction, sometimes stand there while you're shooting them. It was one of the major problems with it.
I do not have this game.
Yeah. Well, maybe it'll be on Prime Day tomorrow, who knows?
That would be funny. I was like, we fixed it. I mean, my thing is, how long has this been going on this is a QA problem. This is straight up a QA problem. How do you have... Nope, I don't have this game at all. That's awesome.
Yeah, and I'm kind of wondering if this is also a developer that found this issue for like somebody else. Just like, I'm going to play Aliens today. Why is this broken? And it goes finds it. It's like, I don't remember if this is like on a very well-known engine like Unreal or something like that.
I think it was Unreal. Yeah. Of course I say that. I've got the internet.
But if you have Alien Colonial Marines for some reason, maybe try this fix. There's an explanation down here. The link will be in the thingy below on YouTube, and I'll just do this for...
Yeah, it was Unreal Twitch. Engine 3.
Yeah.
Colonial Marines. See, the problem here is this is another one of those moments where you can't fix this on Xbox or PlayStation.
Not alluding to anything, though.
Mm-mm.
No.
And we've been talking about, you know, having all these cool consoles this whole time. But at the same time, if I had a choice between having a game like this on PlayStation or Xbox or on PC, I would get it on PC for things like this. Not just the, oh my God, graphics, oh God, this. It's like, that's...
Yeah.
That's a given. But when it comes also that... to fixing things...
And it was like recently I read that... the community out there has like fixed all the textures for the HD re-release of Resident Evil 4 and PC. Now they actually look like pretty damn good in 4K and stuff.
So unless we can figure out how to make these kinds of mods to a PlayStation or Xbox game without violating some kind of code crap, blah, 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 you'll never get these kinds of fixes. So if you are within the unfortunate folks who got Alien Colonial Marines, for example, or the new Resident Evil on a console, you can't get this fixed unless you know, the company that made the game, and Alien game, it's Sega, or the one of the dev companies in there, unless they release a patch to fix it, you're SOL.
Yeah, this game is weird because it was like Gearbox was supposed to be making it, the guys that did Borderlands, and then they like outsourced it to somebody else, even though it's the publisher Sega. So whatever, it probably never gonna get fixed. I highly doubt it for consoles anytime soon. Yeah, I mean, it's not really just that, it's a lot of reasons. PC's overall better, but yeah, I'm not gonna get into that too much. Also, I mean, like, how do you do that when they can't even agree to do crossplay?
That right there comes back from the it would be unfair to certain players. Just remember that. I had a buddy of mine who got a hold of one of those mouse and keyboard mods for his Xbox.
Mm-hmm.
And it actually caused him to become a PC player and start getting into and building I think the last time he put a machine together, he just put together like a Threadripper machine, because he was just like, he does all sorts of stuff, but he built this massive gaming machine plus X because he had this thing on Xbox that allowed him to basically play Xbox games with a mouse and keyboard. And he was like, oh my God, this makes me 1,000 times better. Why would I ever want to go back to playing on a controller?
I was playing GTA the other night when I was playing with people who are primarily console people, and they just happen to have PCs. And so we were all playing. I was the only one using mouse. And it was a match of deathmatch. We were playing deathmatch against each other. It's like a weird mode where it's like we had like power ups or something like that. And yeah, it's like literally they got, between the two of them on one team, they got 21 kills. I got 20 alone. And they're like, I don't understand. It's like, because I can pull off headshots. That's why. But, yeah, I don't know. And then, like, the other question is, too, is, like, is PC evolving more into an Xbox, or is Xbox evolving more into a PC? Because it sounds like they're interested in, like, a platform role there. They're looking more as, a, like, I seriously see Xbox Live as an entire entity just going away, and then maybe to, like, fund that off of their game service thing, whatever they call it, like... You know, like the thing you can pay like $25 for and get like 100 games every month.
Oh, yeah. And I think they're going to, you're going to end up seeing a lot of that kind of stuff merge together to where you're not going to, they're going to make a, they're going to try to make this Windows, you know, Microsoft experience. It's not so much Windows, it's not going to be the Xbox, it's the Microsoft experience where you're going to have, it's just going to, in the back end, it's going to be all the same crap. I don't know. I always kind of laugh when I hear people talking about Xbox Live and I can play with my friends, and I'm going, you've been watching the TV commercials again, haven't you? It's like, well, you can do that on PlayStation. I'm sorry, but rewind. Yeah. We've been doing this for years, man. Catch with the program, which is what Microsoft is now attempting to do, is trying to get with the program and make a new one that takes you away from everything else so that you're not going to want to use things like Discord or Slack or Skype even. You're going to utilize their in-game, in-thing that's, you're not going to want to use Steam. They're going to want you to use the Microsoft audio-visual thing for all of it. And I don't know. When they updated when Windows 10 updated recently to the new, with the latest crazy update, and it changed all of the audio, the audio interface, that made me a little frightened. That whole, it changed everything. And I'm like, you didn't just make things look different. There's a whole, the underbelly of it is very, very different. So this is kind of interesting. It'll be very interesting to see where this is going to go.
I think people are always going to fight back to a certain extent. So I don't think they're going to completely bring everybody over. You know what I mean? Cause like the thing with Discord and stuff is like, on top of that, you have, like, every single person's got a Twitch channel or YouTube channel now has, like, their own Discord.
Yeah.
You know? And as long as there's, like, kind of, like, that kind of media out there, I think they're going to have a hard time against it. Like, if they were smart, they would just use... ditch their own chat system and just use Discord. Because then they don't have to worry about the maintenance or anything on their own end. And they could just throw money at Discord and just be like, here, you handle this for us. You know, that's the way I see it. Because, like, at the end of the day, every chat server is just, you know, some IP that's going to. That's all you have to do inside there is to say, with this game or this, you know, just use this IP to go use your chat. That's all it comes down to. So I don't know why they don't do that. I don't know why Discord's not pushing for that. Maybe they are, but...
Slow progression.
Yeah, very slow. This one I thought was pretty funny. Somebody is making a dongle for the Switch so you can use, I guess, Bluetooth headphones. They just say wireless, but I'm assuming Bluetooth.
Well, that's right, because the Switch doesn't actually come with Bluetooth, which is weird.
No, it does. It actually says on the official Nintendo website that it has Bluetooth 4.1, but they don't enable it.
Well, it does, but it doesn't. I mean, the Joy-Cons themselves operate.
Okay.
The same way the it's the same way that the Wiimotes interface with the Wii, from my understanding, and I believe that it is operating under a Bluetooth technology. I just don't think it's accessible for you to communicate with other devices. I haven't really dug into it too much. I just assumed that it was Bluetooth because it's the Joy-Cons were there, and I figured that the Wiimotes were the same thing because you used to be able to hook up the Wiimotes to your computer.
So is you're thinking the Joy-Cons actually use up enough bandwidth to saturate?
No, I don't. I think the Joy-Cons are just using the tech. I also think that Nintendo has disabled anybody's ability to interface with something else. Because the moment that you open up something like Bluetooth to a to an open allow other devices to communicate with that tech, you start looking at vulnerabilities and other things and all stack of other stuff. Not that it really matters now because we figured this whole thing out.
Yeah.
I'm looking at all the logos on the back of the
I still wonder what they're gonna do to stop that vulnerability. Like, did they just have Nvidia making a new Tegra just for the Switch?
Maybe. I mean, that could be the way things go. Okay, so I've got NYCE, NOM, Nintendo. Normally they have all the cool logos for all the things because you have to put your... I don't know. If I had software-defined radio that I could scan the Bluetooth range, I could look at it more specifically. But I just always assumed that these were Bluetooth. I don't know. Maybe I was wrong. Somebody knows. You could tell me.
I'm sure it is. There goes a plane. Thanks, plane.
But this is kind of funny because it's like you're able to, you know, that was the issue, is that you couldn't hook up headphones to the device. And I'm like, well, okay. How does this actually make that work? I mean, is it?
It's basically intercepting the video feed inline, I guess, when it's in docked mode.
Well, because you can do it when it's docked, and you can do it when it's okay. So I see what it is. You put it into dock mode,
yeah.
Or you plug it in. That's funky. So this is another one of those devices that somebody's making this. They think that there's a need for it, and that people are doing this. And I'm going, it's a portable device.
Yeah.
You know, it's like I've got these. I could connect the audio out of that, out of the HDMI, into something and have wireless headphones plugged into it if it's on a dock.
Yeah.
Otherwise, if it was connected, if it's not, it's a portable device. Wireless everything. Oh, wireless everything.
So I guess
what
my
do you
want
to have it connected to your phone at the same time?
It's it works now, right? And Kagato, thank you for the 100 bits, man. It works now where it's the microphone input on the headphone jack does work, right?
I believe so. I don't know. I don't know.
I read something about Fortnite.
Up until yesterday, when I realized that this mod that you can do is no longer firmware dependent, or at least up to 5.1. I hadn't connected it to the network at all, and the only reason I even considered updating it was because Octopath Traveler required the console to be at a newer version, so you could play the damn game. And I'm like, okay, well. Either A, I'm not playing the game, or B, I'm modding the crap out of it first and then hoping that the mod sticks around after I update the firmware, fun saying goes. And then I just started digging into it. I'm like, oh, totally. So I just said, screw it, got it on the Wi-Fi and updated the damn thing. But I haven't had any need for headphones. I've never tried playing it on headphones. I leave it on the dock. I use it as a...
I think there is a need for it, though. Like, I remember when I had my PlayStation 3, I had to get those wireless headphones because I was in a situation where somebody would be sleeping at night, and that was the only time I had the game, you know?
Well, like, yeah, but you're not going to connect it. Did you connect it directly to the PlayStation, or did you connect it to your stereo system?
No. It was, like, the PlayStation one. There was just a TV and a PlayStation. That was it. There was no stereo system or anything like that. So, yeah, I can see the need a little bit there. So anyways,
back in my day, we had to run long cables and wire things into something else and then over there and then around this. And then we'd put some headphones on and then you had to hope to God that you didn't feed it back somewhere and make this loud noise at 2 o'clock in the morning when you're playing.
Hey, look, cables.
Yeah. See those things.
Yeah.
Is that the new one?
Yeah.
You and your new toys. USB Nintendo controller. Meh.
I don't think so, but it's only 3 feet, so there you go.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, I went to go look for cable extensions for this thing, walked into a GameStop, and the guy was like, he points to one of these, right? He goes, this has a longer cable. I'm like, That's an extra controller. He's like, yeah, they have longer cables. I'm like, no, they don't. And he's like, yeah, they do. And I'm like, I bought this on, like, you know, a week before the system came out and have a video on YouTube. So do you want to tell me a different story or should I just get my phone out and show you?
It's like, look, listen, son, I've already done my research.
Yeah. Anyways. Last thing I'll talk about here real quick, as far as like sort of canned stuff we got going on. GPU pricing, it's going down. Cryptocurrency demand has dwindled. 10 series overstock, which is a new one on me. I didn't hear about that. And I don't know if I agree with this. 11 series inbound. Do you really think the 11 series is coming out this summer? I don't.
If it's not coming out, they're definitely going to announce it, I think. They haven't already. Did they announce it?
But the thing is like all the rumors are saying that AMD's not even set to release anything until next year.
Yeah.
So I don't know.
The 10 series overstock, that part I do believe is a major Taiwanese OEM returned the 300,000. That I did hear about that.
Yeah.
And the funny part, what I think is hilarious, is that they returned 300,000 10 series NVIDIA GPUs. But they didn't return a graphics card. They returned like the chips.
The chips. Gotcha.
So that's like pre-manufactured chips. So they now have almost 500,000 GPUs that they can now put into things.
Yeah.
Which means they have a supply that they can send out to other places.
Yeah. I don't know, like, they're saying, like, wait a little bit longer. I found, we were looking yesterday, the 1060s are still about 260. I found a RX 580 8GB for... Why are the alerts still working? I deleted all the scenes.
I don't know, you have a... Oh.
Well, I have to wait for the sex song to be over now.
Yeah.
I'm going to eradicate OBS after this.
Dude.
I mean, is it part of OBS or do you have it built into your Twitch stream? I haven't done this in a while, so I have to relearn.
See,
all this
stuff. When you put like your browser link in to OBS, like you can do like a browser link or whatever, and then it brings up like the link to like Streamlabs.
Sure.
Okay, that's where it pulls from, but the actual. Like, I've never had it in the show scenes before, so it was only in the actual stream scenes before, so I've actually deleted every single one of those, and for some reason, it's still pulling the audio.
Are you using Streamlabs OBS or regular OBS?
This is regular OBS for this. I use Streamlabs for the actual, like, game streams and stuff like that.
Oh, okay. So then my other question is this, are those alerts now built into Twitch?
News to me if they are. Anyways, Crafty, thank you for the 3 months, man. No, you're fine. It's my fault. Or not my fault. I don't know. Who knows? Anyways.
This is why it's a trial.
Yeah. Anyways.
21 times. You think we can figure this out? We're taking out for Microsoft here.
Yeah. I'm trying to, like, you know. But anyways, thank you, dude. It's not that I'm not appreciative, guys. It's just that I thought I fixed that. But apparently not. Anyway,
I can't even hear it, so I don't even know what's going on. And I had to go to I had to turn the volume up on the actual live stream. I was like, oh.
Yeah. Well, every time it's 3 months sub, I figure third date, so we had sex.
Gotcha. That makes sense.
Yeah.
So, I think that we're gonna see the prices drop regardless. I think the fact that they spiked up the way they did was your retailers being asshats, honestly.
Mm-hmm.
That was my thoughts on the whole nine yards. It's when you have a bunch of stuff that's already in stock and you have people coming in and buying it by the truckload, you're looking at, you know, it's gonna sell. These guys, those retailers already bought them at that point.
The other thing I would say too is, like, a lot of people are like, don't buy a mining card. I would say absolutely buy a mining card now, because just check it out, make sure the condition's good on it. If at all, like, the thing's probably gonna go bad is a fan, and that's easily replaced with, like, an Arctic cooling, like heat sink or something like that. But most of the miners that I know now have actually, like, undervolted their GPUs, so they're not even, like, running hot or running fast at all. I think a lot of that will be flooding, a lot more of that will be flooding the market pretty soon. But my main thing I would say is, like, if you're sitting there gonna, like, wait months and months for the 11 series card, it's not even been confirmed. Just buy a 10 series, be happy with it. You know, like, I always end up skipping a generation anyways. So
I have an RX 480 that I picked mm-hmm. up for $300 mm-hmm. back when the 580s were just announced, or roughly 300. I don't remember what I paid for it. No, I'm thinking about it. It wasn't very expensive. It was an 8 gig card. It's fantastic. Yeah. It's what's running all of this fancy stuff. Yeah. I need another monitor. I need to push that thing to its limits, man. I probably put more work on the card in my system than most of your mining machines do. Serious.
Yeah.
24/7. Yeah. Well, if you're a bad mining if you're a bad miner, don't worry. It'll be closed with your non-adult record. No, if you're cooling the things properly and you're keeping your mining rigs in a system, in an environment that's not ridiculously over humified or humid, you know, it's not too humid and it's not too dry and it's not too hot, not too cold, and it's just a nice functional. It's no different than buying a server, like a used server. Those machines are put in data centers and they're used to crunch numbers and whatnot. The only thing you ever really want to be concerned with buying used is a hard drive, and that's because there could be remnants of very bad things on there, or the drive itself could just be at the end of its end of its life and die.
Yeah. So anyways, have at it. Buy now. If you need it now, buy now. Don't, you know, you can wait if you want, but like I said, I saw an RX 580 yesterday for 8 gig for $219.
That's amazing. That's great. Yeah. What brand was it?
It was Power Color. It was one of the Red Devils.
Okay.
Yeah. So anyways, there's that. Oh well. I got nothing else. I just thought tangent was more fun today. I like this tangent. I like going off about hacking and projects and other things. I'm trying to figure out, like, if I want to go and hack my lawnmower next.
So then you can shrink your kids?
Sure. No, it has, so it's kind of dumb. It's an electric lawnmower that has a lithium ion battery, and it says 56 volts, but you can actually get it to go up to like 60. So it's supposed to have a system in it where it like turbos itself up, but I just like want a button that I can just mash and just have it go 60 because it doesn't work half the time. It also scares the neighbors. It really sounds pretty fucking wicked when it goes to 60.
That's awesome.
But
I'm looking at like an auto mower or something that's like, you know, remote controlled or an automatic.
I would have that.
There's a couple of companies that have those auto mowers already out, and they've been out for years, which is crazy.
So I would actually have that, but the problem is I have wildlife around here. It doesn't understand what a lawnmower is and not very afraid of it for whatever reason. Like, deer would just, like, walk up to it.
That's what the gun turret on top of it's for.
So what you're really talking about is turning one of those iRobot, like, gun robots into a lawnmower?
Yes. Sort of. Yes. Okay. No, seriously, if you had a mower that was automatic and just rode it, you know, what is it doing? It's patrolling the yard. It's also mowing the lawn. It's two birds, one stone.
Yeah.
In this case, two birds, one shot. The damn thing laser guided to line them up and took them both out.
The thing short to ground is that if I was to sit on the porch, it would only work for this one piece here, and I wouldn't be able to see any of this over here. So that's not. Anyways, I could do that. But then Why not just like stick razor blades on an RC car and go really fast?
I'm all about lawnmowers. Lawnmowers are great. As long as I don't have to use them. That's why I'm all about auto lawn mowing. I don't like mowing the lawn. It means I have to go outside during the day with the sun out.
Yeah.
Ooh.
It's warm. It's
really warm. No, it is. It's ridiculously hot. You know, people talk about climate change. I don't care who anybody is. If you think that 75 degrees Fahrenheit is cold, y'all need to move to the equator. Stop trying to migrate it north. Look, yeah. Right now it is 32 Celsius outside where I am. 32 Celsius is well over 80. I don't even know. It's hot. My brain stops thinking about 25 Celsius. Yeah, that's that's not cool.
Yeah.
25 is 77. That is too hot. 22 is good. 25 is bad. I do not like 25. 32 is 90. 89.6. It's almost body temperature outside. That's terrible. This is why I got out of Arizona, because in Arizona, it was, you know, 50. Literally, it was 50 degrees Celsius in Arizona, which is 120.
Well, you lived here, so you know. It isn't necessarily warm outside, but everybody and their grandmother, for some reason, doesn't have AC here, so it gets warm. And for the past couple days, it's been getting up to 85, 90 degrees in the afternoon. And it's like, come on, Washington. You know there's a thing called air conditioners. Start putting them in your apartments and homes. I'm wondering at which point does the Northwest here actually change and go like, yeah, we need ACs.
When I was in Portland, it was 103 outside. I was on the southwest side of the building on the fourth floor. It was 122 in my apartment. I had to shut down all my computers. Closing the drapes didn't help. And there was no AC in the apartment. There was AC in the hallway. So everybody on my floor had literally opened up their door and sat inside their apartment with a fan blowing the cold air into their apartment.
Crafty. So,
the answer is yesterday. A couple years back is when you needed that.
So we got 1% of 97 now. Crafty says, what the fuck is this Celsius shit? We use freedom units here.
92 freedom, yeah, not 32C. I worked for a British company for 5 years, so all of my crap switched over to Celsius because I had to interact with most people not in this country. Even now, I still interact mostly with people overseas, so it's just... everything just stayed that way, and I'm too lazy to switch it back.
Yeah. So anyways, what you got working on, man? You got any projects coming up? Are you coming back to YouTube? Are you permanently off YouTube?
Me?
Are you going to be a shadow in the background?
So the issue that I ran into is we hit summertime, and I had no real airflow in the vault. Because, you know, when you're in an underground bunker, you need to get some airflow. So I had to get a mini split air conditioning unit installed, which just got installed like 9 days ago. And it has allowed this place to not be an oven. So in order to, when it was an oven, I had to shut all my servers down because it was getting too hot in here. And trying to record anything with the servers going was bad. With them off, it means I'm not... It was just... I needed to cool the damn place off. I couldn't think straight. So recording anything, I had to turn the lights on. Lights caused more heat, caused the place to get up to closer to 90 inside the vault. So I was like, crap. So now that I have the AC in here, I've been trying to figure out what exactly is going to be the functional temperature, turning servers back on, finding that nice noise to heat ratio. But I've got a laundry list of videos that I've actually got lined up to make. It's just... that was going on. I was gone for DreamHack in Austin. Then I was in New York for a job. I was bouncing all over the place for both work related stuff. So I actually have to go up and chit chat with Wendell at some point. So that'll be a thing. No, I've got a whole stack of YouTube videos in the works. along with some information regarding some storage shells and some other things. And speaking of storage shells, that was another issue that I had. I was working on this. This is the electromagnet for my vault door. Some of the parts that I needed for this were buried in the bottom of a storage closet that I have here in the vault. And I had to pull everything out of the closet in order to get to it, which was kind of a nightmare. It turned the vault into a giant storage room, which was annoying. So then I couldn't move around or, you know, record anything because this room is filled with crap. And yeah. At that moment, I was like, you know what? Screw it. I'm just going to build some shelves. And it turned into building one shelf into building three shelves that can on wheels that can roll in and out of the storage closet that maximize the space in there. So I did that instead.
I just started going to your route, your old route, when it comes to YouTube. I just started taking this and shooting stuff on this. And even in some cases, editing and uploading from this. And...
Yeah. It's great. I still use the phone as one of my recording devices, and it's great because it's got all the bells and whistles that you need for a very simple point and click and record with lights.
Yeah.
The fact that it can shoot in 4K is fantastic. The fact that I've got I can do 1080-60 on here. I can do 1080-60 on the GX8, so I can bounce between the two. So if I'm moving around with something, I've got this thing, and then if I want to go to the other camera, I can static shot that or zoom in, zoom out, whatever. Yeah. I need to do. So there's a lot of work.
It's gotten to the point where I came to the realization. I started talking to a lot of streamers and YouTubers and stuff, and the amount of viewers that you need to actually make a full-on living out of it. And we're not just talking about AdSense. We're talking about, like, you know, ad placement in the videos and stuff like that. Like, you're eating ramen for a long time before you get anywhere. So I just come to the conclusion, it's just a hobby at this point, and I'll have, like, a full-time job and all that stuff, and just, you know. And that's pretty much it. When I have something to say, this comes out, I say it, it goes online, and I go about my day.
Yeah.
You know, that's pretty much the way I'm treating it now. So stuff like this is fun. You know, because I don't get to talk to people about like-minded things very much. It's usually nonsensical crap that I'm like, okay.
Yeah, well, I mean, when I am talking to people about stuff, when I'm talking to people in general about cool nerdy stuff, there is some business angle that's stuck behind it that means I can't put it online. I can't talk about it in the open. It's all hush hush. I get to chit chat with people when I'm talking about DreamHack stuff, which is awesome. So I'm going to be, I was at DreamHack Austin, and that was really neat. But I couldn't talk about any of that, mostly, even to some of the team members for a long while. Now I'm going to be at DreamHack Atlanta, and I can say that I'm going to be there. I'm saying it's going to be cool. I can tell you it's going to be different and better than last year. As long as some bulldozer doesn't cut up the fiber cable again. But otherwise, no. I wish that was a joke, but that's actually what happened. But other than that, I can't really talk too much about what the changes are going to be or what it's going to, how it's going to be better. It's just that's kind of where it's at.
Yeah.
So there's no. But otherwise, I've got a couple of other really crazy things that I've been looking at. I really like the idea of working with these LAN parties. DreamHack is just because I was able to get in on the ground level, makes it really awesome. And as long as I can, maintain that presence, I'm hoping something cool comes out of that. But I've also been put in contact with a lot of really awesome people, like people who run LANFest. The Intel LANFest. That is something that I'm hoping to be a little more involved with as time goes on, but I don't know the how or the when of that. All reality, I would love to throw a LAN party of, you know, bigger than the last one that I threw, maybe I'd like to do 1,000 people. Would be awesome. But that is a big project, because in order to make it, we talk about cost of renting a venue is not cheap, like at all. So you're looking at, if you wanted to keep the ticket sales for BYOC at like $75, like QuakeCon is $75 for that venue in QuakeCon. Are you going to be at QuakeCon?
No, I'm not going to this year. My eventual goal is once I, so for anybody that doesn't know, I know Kane knows. Part of the reason we've been gone for so long is A, he's been busy. B, I've been in school to get my CDL. So once I get the truck thing figured out and figure out my time, the idea is I get enough off time that the YouTube channel becomes whatever the hell I want to talk about on top of covering all these events that I'm going to. Like basically like vlog style. Like I want to go to like QuakeCon. I want to go to like DreamHack. I want to go to all these other events and just like, you know, and sit there with the cell phone and go, hey, what's up, everybody? And put videos up.
Whoa, hold on. Crafty Hack's talking about the Kansas City one.
Yeah, he's
sorry,
the,
I don't mean to interrupt you. I know.
He's essentially the marketing guy for it.
Yeah, I'm just like, wait a minute, when is that one? Are we going to be there?
It's that one I might be at. That's November 30th, I believe.
Okay, might be able to make that one.
Yeah. He's telling me about that one. They also have board games and apparently an area with a bunch of old consoles and stuff. So it's like people just show up to do that.
You do know that DreamHack is November 18th, right? DreamHack Atlanta?
No.
Oh, well, that's November 18th. Just as so he knows, because that's kind of close there. Otherwise, that sounds awesome. And that's in Kansas City, right?
Yeah.
Or Wichita.
No, Kansas City.
All right. Wow, look at that. All these guys showing up saying hi. Yeah, no, I'd love to come to that. That'd be awesome.
Yeah.
We'll have to share an Airbnb.
Hold me. Anyways.
Yeah, well, I can't. Yeah. I can do that.
Yeah. Anyways, I'm going to cut off there. I'm just going to end this by saying on Twitch, YouTube. Look, nothing bad happened. I'm just saying that because apparently if I put videos up saying I'm live on Twitch on YouTube, YouTube hits me now with like the smackdown.
Well, they'll definitely do that to some other people we know.
Yeah. We can't acknowledge that Twitch exists on YouTube, even though it was a platform that was originally made to help you get your content out on the internet and possibly drive people to other places.
Yeah. I think it has more to do with the fact that they don't want people blatantly advertising on one platform for the other.
Yeah.
And so I don't know. It's a fine line. Again, I do want to touch on this before we go, because we kind of briefly touched on this. And this is one of those things where when you look at some of those big channels that have put in a lot of time and effort into making this stuff work, they are no longer just, it's not a hobby. Like, you know, we're doing this kind of as it's hobby level for us. Even if we wanted to turn it into a business, we have to treat it like a business to do that. And the business is, you know, what is the business at that point? And the business that you're making is a production company. You are making a production company. You should be able to produce content and publish it wherever you want within certain exclusive agreements that you sign up for. So that's why when you look at like becoming a Twitch partner, you are signing an exclusive agreement with Twitch that you will be publishing your video content onto their platform. It's the same thing that you'd look at if you look at Hawaii Five-O, for example. It's a show. Mm-hmm. It is produced by there's a production company that's making that, and it's either owned by the network or it's paid for by the network, one of the two. And if it's paid for by the network, that means that it's a production company making this show, putting it on television, and the exclusive agreement they have with the network is that it will be put onto this channel at this time. And that way, the network that is publishing that has the ability to sell large quantities of advertisements. And with that show, I was saying this earlier when we were kind of, before we got online, is that that show itself is a giant advertisement. And it is one of the best advertisements I have ever seen, ever. It is literally the best advertising campaign I've ever seen, hands down. and it's an advertising campaign for the Microsoft Surface, or Microsoft in general, an advertising campaign for Hawaiian Airlines, the Hawaii tourism industry, and it is also an advertisement for Chevy. Hawaii 5-0.
That's a good point, yeah.
If you watch any episode, and I mean that, any episode, you can tell when they had to doctor the script to make some random feature.
I remember watching it. Yeah, there was literally scenes where they're using like the Microsoft wall or something like that. Like they have like one of those in their headquarters or something like that.
They've got one of the big display screens on the ground on a it's a table monitor.
Oh, okay.
But it's also a touch screen. But all of the 5-0 members, actually anybody on the show, has a Microsoft Surface. And they'll either have a shot where they flip out the Surface and then they have to click on the Microsoft, you know, the Metro interface to access the 5-0 crime fighting program, or they have to access Skype. The Skype is my favorite because they actually have to go in and they click on Skype and they have to click on their contact, and it's this 4-second clip of them accessing a contact on Skype, just so you can see they're using Skype. Hawaii 5-0 and the Honolulu Police Department, they use Skype to communicate. It's like, wow, it is so crazy. The show gets even crazier because then you've got the all the cars that they drive are Chevys. Then they've got the Hawaiian Airlines is every single time anybody comes to Hawaii, they must be using Hawaiian Airlines. They has to be Hawaiian Airlines. You can't fly there on any other airline. There's no other airline at the airport, only Hawaiian Airlines. It's even in the damn intro to the show, is the Hawaiian airline airplane. Anyway, I just thought that was absolutely fantastic. But back to the tangent that I somehow dug myself into here, is a production company. You know, if you are a YouTuber, you are a production company. The contracts that you sign to get into AdSense, or you get into like Twitch Prime, or not Twitch Prime, you get into Twitch Partner, Twitch Affiliates, those are production company, you know, in certain aspects of it. Some of them, they treat you like an employee, and other aspects of it, they're treating you like an independent contractor. And in other elements, in some of the contracts that you have to sign to utilize any of these platforms, you are basically signing in as a production company that is a sole proprietorship under yourself, or it is a, you know, an LLC, or you can get an S corp. I mean, there's all sorts of different things, but all of those things are those are all elements that you have to take into consideration with all this. So, and under that idea, if you had Hawaii 5-0, Wayne's World made a prime. No, that's fantastic. Yeah. You're absolutely right. They hit that on the nose, and that's what you see in Hawaii 5-0. It's fantastic. Anyway, but if you were to watch that show, and in the middle of that show, they had either a reference or some kind of statement that go watch this show or a different show on a different network at the same time, so you have to click away from the show that you're watching, that would be a big problem. Like that wouldn't fly. That would never make it on the air.
So yeah, I brought that up with the Reebok. Yeah, also ibuprofen, I think, was the other one.
Like a leave or something.
When Mike Myers was making that movie, he said he always hated how they put like the product placements in the background. and so the movie studio just like said, you need here's some, and they said, no, just give us more, we need a couple more. And they're like, okay, because they didn't know what was going on, you know. And he just did that whole scene just ham-fisted, where they just put all the product placement in one single scene, and the movie studio apparently got really pissed off at him.
Well, it's because they're making a mockery of the whole thing. Yeah.
Nuprin.
Little yellow.
Yellow different. They even had the black, like the filter with just the yellow pills.
See, that's a prime example of making a mockery about it. Like, I think the first time I realized that they were getting a little more blatant, like you said, they're always in the background. It's always like, that's over there. That's a product placement. I put that there specifically. I'm getting paid for that thing, whatever that happened to thing that I'm. Oh yeah, it's this painting. I'm getting paid for the painting. You look at I think it was how this must have been back. This was like 2000. I want to say it was 2009, 2010. I was at a friend's place and they put on True Blood. And this one episode of True Blood that I thought was absolutely hilarious, because the whole scene didn't make any sense. And it makes you think that the writers were like, hell no, we're not doing this. Absolutely not. And then the network's like, no, you're doing this. It's already done. You have to figure out how to make it work. Like, fine, we're doing it. And it's the only scene in the entire show that does this as so blatantly as this is. And it's a scene where they cut to the restaurant and there's these two extras. They're not even like regulars on the show. They're just random. It's a spoken part, but it's completely non sequitur. And they're having a conversation about what's happening in the show, but it's all generic garbledy crap. And then the waitress walks up and makes some smart ass comment in response to her, or something else happens. She's like, would you like some more Mountain Dew? And she's like, what? Oh, I would love some more Mountain Dew. And they pours a pitcher of Mountain Dew. It doesn't have it, and there's no can. There's no actual product on place. It was just that they said it like three times in the span of like 10 seconds on the show, and that's it. That's like, that was the whole point. You're going, anybody else see that? Anybody else want a Mountain Dew? It's like, what? That was weird. That was so weird. And yeah, I mean, they've been doing that forever, but holy crap, that's.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. As a child, the first time I've noticed it in any kind of media as a blatant advertisement is when I got TMNT2 on the original NES, the arcade version, because it had a thing on there for Pizza Hut all over the place. Get like a free pan pizza, and Pizza Hut was all over the damn game. Like everywhere. Like in April's apartment, there were for some reason paintings of the Pizza Hut logo with like little display lights on top of it and everything. Made no sense to me, but.
Well, she works in television, so she clearly knows about product placement.
Yeah, and then Crafty has a interesting idea. He's noticed that every time PC Purr streams, they have Coke cans with the label always facing the camera.
Oh yeah, see, I that's actually something else that you always see in shows, that they'll be drinking something, and they'll either be covering up the label. And then they sit it down, and if they're not, they're very carefully, like, I can't do it with this can because the drink is here, so I have to put myself here to the camera, so you can see the see the label clearly. Oh, that was the other thing. There is a local brewery in Hawaii, and I assume that it's a local brewery because I've never heard of this beer before. They mention the beer by name in almost every episode, and every single time they're drinking, they're drinking that beer. And it is, it's called like Longboard or something.
Yeah.
And it's a Hawaiian, Hawaiian beer. And that's what they all drink in that show. If you took out all of the product placement in that show, you'd have about 10 seconds of somebody shooting somebody. And that makes me wonder, actually, no, you wouldn't even have that, because they've got to the point where they've mentioned Beretta by name. They mentioned Glock by name. They don't mention they mention M4s or M40s and other rifles, but they specifically mention Beretta and Glock. And I'm going, really? No, somebody does have to pay for the show. But that's like, in addition to the on-air advertisements, like commercial breaks, this is all in the show.
Yeah. It's great. Like, I almost kind of appreciate it in a way.
There's this, when it's creatively done, I think it's awesome. When it's things like the True Blood episode, that one right there made me really cringe, because it was you could tell that the writers were like, no, hell no, why you gotta mess with our no, like we've never, why would we, no.
You remember in Star Trek when the communications devices all became Nokias?
Well then, yeah.
Yeah. Anyways, I like what Britt just said. He's like, weird. He's like, man, I need a Mountain Dew and a pizza. Weird, I just ate.
Right?
Yeah, sorry.
Anyway, I kind of get a chuckle out of it because I sit back and I'm like, what company can I talk to that will get me a new insert XYZ headphones, chair, mouse, keyboard? I'm like, that right there is what a lot of Twitch people do. Yeah. They will get offered a piece of product that will need to be on camera in order for them to get it and not have to pay for it, or they'll even throw some money their way. And then it's not that they don't have to endorse it, they just have to sit in the damn chair. And in the process of them having that chair on camera, on screen, people will ask questions and then the conversation happens by itself.
Yeah, Nokia happened to Star Trek in one of the first movies. Me and Kane are both using SteelSeries headsets. No reason to mention that.
This thing right here, I had a video actually filmed for this headset years ago, and it never got published because my publishing company, it fell through the cracks. So it never got published. There you go. Like how I did that? And then the base unit, this is the wireless one. So the base unit actually broke. It stopped charging. It stopped charging the battery, and it stopped acknowledging the headset altogether. So the antenna radio started messing up, and I went out and bought a new one because I liked it so much. And these are not cheap. Oh my God, are these not cheap?
Yeah. I'm seriously considering getting an Arctis Pro wireless because I like the idea of Bluetooth and wireless at the same time, so I can go back and forth from the phone.
Like, no, I could see that.
Yeah,
I don't know. I've got a there was a company that did a Kickstart for a wireless earbuds. They are, each earbud is independent and they sit in your ear. Since then, there's like two other companies that have come out with one, and one of them has, I think that it was a bigger company, and they put the whole thing into like an Indiegogo or Kickstarter, and they already had all of the, the manufacturing already kind of squared out and ready to go before they did the Indiegogo or the Kickstarter, because the company that I did, that I backed, we were supposed to have them last fall, but due to the company that was sourcing the batteries, the manufacturer that we were sourcing the batteries from, I say we because I'm part of the backing company, right? They decided that they had a better offer from somebody else and sold like their entire stock to a different company for the next six months to a year. So we had to go back to the manufacturing drawing board and have to redesign the entire headphone with a different battery, which was kind of annoying. So now here we are. We're supposed to have them by this fall. So I'm hoping to get those because they have a little charging case. You plug the charging case in, and the charging case itself has a battery that charges the earpieces, and the earpieces can operate for like 3 hours.
So and then you stick them. iPod or was it AirPod?
Yeah, in that way. So you got the headphones in the case. The case can charge the headphones up to three times before you have to recharge the case. So you can have up to 9 hours of playtime over the course of a 12-hour period, because I think it takes like an hour and a half to charge the headphones.
Nice. Well, anyways.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm done with my tangent. We're good.
We're at an hour and a half. I'm going to go ahead and cut it here.
What?
Ugh. Yeah. Well, to be fair, we're probably not going to do this for a couple more weeks. So, there you go.
Yeah.
Extra long one.
I'm going to be gone for almost a month.
Yeah. What I might do is I might have somebody else on to fill it in that spot. And then when you come back and, you know, come back into the seat and whatnot. But I don't know.
I'll be sitting in that chair next time.
Huh? Sit in that chair?
Yeah, I'll sit in the other chair next time.
In your robe?
Yes, in that fancy room.
Okay.
Where am I going? I'm going to Nebraska, and then I'm going to Wyoming, and then I'm going to Dallas, and then I'm probably going to Phoenix.
Damn. the traveling nomad.
Yeah.
All right. Well, anyways, guys, you can follow us on our handles on Twitter, Twitch, YouTube, Deus Kane, Cell Processing. It's kind of easy. We're that everywhere.
Yeah.
So, yeah. And, yeah, once again, YouTube. YouTube. YouTube.
YouTube is great.
Or is it? I don't know. Anyways. Bye.